So welcome to Cranbourne Music. Here we are. Actually, it's not Cranbourne Music anymore. It is Coleman's Music.
The whole point of this.
That's right. I forgot. I'm sorry about that.
Welcome to Coleman's Music.
Thanks for coming in. This is really exciting. And thanks to our beautiful musos here for coming in. We got Greg and Nat from Press Club. And we got Joel from Mid-City. Yes!
You guys are all so polite. It's a Saturday night, right?
Yeah, that's right.
It's Saturday night.
Yeah. Oh, shit.
I can't believe you put this on a Saturday.
I know, what kind of idiot came up with that idea?
They're all free.
I can't believe we said yes on a Saturday.
I can't believe you were free on a Saturday.
Sorry, I guess I should speak into this.
Yeah, perfect. Thank you very much. We are recording this as well. Hello to everyone at home watching this in a week's time as well.
Oh,
that's
cool.
Fantastic. The future is now. We also have Hanny J coming in as well. She's on her way, so she should be here pretty soon. She's going to come running through the middle of this shot and... hopefully grab a microphone and join you guys on the couch. But yeah, so we've invited you all down here because we want to talk about songwriting. It's the most important part of Coleman's Music, and we don't sell it, so that's pretty weird. But where would we be without it? These are three of my dear friends who I think are incredibly skilled at it. So we've invited them down to come and do it. So. Wanted to kick it off with the most obvious question of all. What is your current strategy for songwriting? How does it come about in its current form? Do you want to kick it off?
Oh, geez, we were talking about this before, going, what questions is Nick going to ask us? And he asked the most difficult one first. So, oh, man, come on.
Fill some time.
Strategy. I actually had to think about this on the way down. This very question, because I knew he'd ask it. And I reckon, and tell me if I'm wrong here, people, but a strategy for me, there's like two forms. One is to sit and write until you come up with something good, and then stop when you get something good, and you build up your confidence again, I actually got somewhere. And the other way is to not write anything at all for ages and let it sort of build up in you, like, I don't know, I need some analogy here.
A poo, yes,
like a poo.
Eventually it's got to come out.
Yeah, I knew Nick was here for a reason. Perfect. But I found both ways work. Like, actually, the second way works better. If you go, you know, if you're on a long train ride or something and you don't have an instrument in hand, or you just, I don't know, you've been busy at work and you haven't written for a while, and then you sit down, you're far more likely to get a whole bunch of things come out. But at the same time, you get used to that, and then you go, all right, I won't bother putting in the work of sitting down and writing and writing and writing and writing, which I think is kind of equally important. Nah.
Put in the work. Nah, I go heaps of stints without writing anything. And then if I have gotten to if I am doing lots of writing, at some point I feel like I burn out and I run out of like things to talk about, things to sing about. So yeah, I guess there are the two kind of approaches. Once I burn out, just stop. Stop writing, wait a couple of months, and then all of a sudden I'll just do it again.
But that's for lyrics, right? So do you find if you burn out from writing lyrics, you have to go out and have a crazy night or some kind of crazy adventure to inspire you to do it again?
No, sometimes I can just go for a walk around the park.
Ooh, that's convenient.
Yeah.
That's some park you live by.
Is everyone here in a band or writing songs at the moment? Yeah, no, we've got good, most people. Al's not. Okay, great, good.
Come on, Al.
Right, well, yeah, hopefully this will be beneficial.
Greg, I guess they're both kind of talking maybe potentially from a lyrical point of view, potentially.
Yeah.
And are you talking about processes in the entire, like overarching, how a song will come together?
Well, I was hoping now that they've been kind of overarching, maybe you can refine it into like one song.
Yeah.
What's the journey of one song?
Yeah, I guess, I mean, for us, it's evolved over the years, and now we're on, I guess, writing for a third record. It's definitely changed, and I guess that's the thing about the songwriting process is that it has to change. Like, it can't be the same the whole time. And so when we first started writing music, it was maybe someone would bring just a guitar riff, or I'd bring a guitar riff to the band as a whole, and then we'd always collaborate in a rehearsal room.
We could literally just like write a song from nothing.
Yeah.
Back in the early days when we were all so like...
Yeah, just fresh with ideas.
Fresh.
Yeah.
That's, That's the right word.
And then I guess from that point, once you had the kernel of an idea, we'd create a form around it. And then Nat would have done that work, I guess, what you guys are talking about, in her own time, written a bunch of lyrics and then be able to herself be able to improvise over what we've kind of put together as a band. And I guess from that process then, I think in the early days it was just like literally an iPhone in the middle of a band room, which I'm sure pretty much everyone here has kind of done. And we would listen to it, you know, months later and go, was that good? You know, have some kind of organizational system, hopefully, as rudimentary as it would have been back in the day. But
our general rule is like write as many songs as we can and then pick the ones that we are extremely connected to and totally. That we think have legs.
That was definitely a breakthrough for us. It's almost like the quantity over quality to begin with, because then you have just so much more to whittle down later on when it comes to, you know, working out what is going to be a record at the end of the day. You know, you're trying to get to sort of maybe 8 to 10 to 12 songs. So the more that you have to pull from and go, well, that's crap, that one's got something in it that we could work on, you know. So I guess the more that you can throw at it, for us personally, works well.
But you guys also have kind of, I mean, actually you do as well, there's songs that come from like a collaborative aspect in a room together, everyone's holding their instrument or their microphone or whatever and they're working on the thing together. Mm-hmm. And then there's songs that come from like, you know, in a separated aspect, like you write at home and then bring it into the room, right?
Yeah, this, like for our most... Hanny!
Yes!
Hanny.
Everyone, this is Hanny. Welcome.
Yeah.
We're still on the first question, so you're all sweet.
Yeah, we haven't gotten very far. For this record that we're writing at the moment, is probably the big change that we've made is that everyone's been putting in the work outside of that little band room collaboratively writing space. And now it's a lot more like someone is coming up with an idea that's a little bit more fully formed and I'm writing lyrics to them outside of getting into the room and doing it.
That was probably a byproduct of everyone being completely separated as well. Like we couldn't collaborate for 11 months or something like that, which I'm sure everyone here has kind of experienced last year. So, yeah, it forced us into going, well, everyone's kind of have to pull their finger out and just do stuff at home and work out how to use whatever kind of audio software that you can to make an idea that makes sense when you send it to someone.
Yeah. That's probably a pretty important one, is like just figuring out some sort of audio software.
Yeah.
I feel like once...
Well, I've got a question about that. We'll get to that.
Don't go shut it, Nat.
To that. Yeah. Sorry.
We'll get there, guys.
Now that you're here, Hanny, can we ask you, what is the most common current process for you seeing a song to completion, whether it be in your solo stuff or with the band?
Writing a song?
Yeah, yeah. Like, do you start with an acoustic guitar or...?
Yeah, it's really different.
Microphone.
Oh, yeah. Good talking. Right. Yeah.
It's really different for my solo stuff and the band that I'm in. I'm kind of just in two bands at the moment. Clowns, the band that I'm in, like one of them we like write together mainly in the room, which is really weird for me because I'm a really personal writer. So I've been in this band for like 4 years and it's still really weird for me to do that. And I thought like, yeah, for sure, I'll like roll in and write like at least 3 songs, like, you know, at least. And I couldn't, I just like overthought it. And when I'd be there with them, I couldn't kind of mull over the riffs and everything like that I usually do, and it's kind of like all been a positive because it's like made me realize what does work for me, and like it's also taken me outside my comfort zone, like obviously, and I think it's good to write with different people. And
I find I get so nervous if I ever try to write a song with anyone else aside from my band. Like we've gained so much trust with each other over the past like 10 years of writing together.
Yeah.
Mm. I freak the fuck out when I go to anybody else.
Right.
Yeah.
That's interesting. So there's trust involved there.
So much trust.
That's good. All right. So I think it's quite common for people to find lyricism to be one of the most challenging aspects of songwriting. what do you do to get started lyrically, and do you often write with an overarching intention of what the song will be about, or do you find the meaning as you go?
I'll take it.
Yeah, go.
You added too many words at the end of that, so I've forgotten the second half of the question, but it's all right. I think I got the vibe.
Good.
I tend to like to get a specific melody line with a like one sentence of lyrics that feel nice.
Mm.
And that's my starting point.
Okay.
On basically every thing.
Like,
and then
you have to have a hook to the, that becomes the hook to the song.
Not necessarily the hook, it could be any part of the song. It could be like a random line in the bridge, but just be like getting this one tiny section is like, it's crazy how much I'll go like, oh, that line is about this. And I'm like, okay, that's what the whole song is about now.
Yeah.
Where I would, if I didn't have that, I would never go, I'm going to write a song about this. Because I don't really work in a way that that is like going and writing something specific. Like, I want to write a song about something. It's very much like, but there's the line, and then all of a sudden I'm like, oh, right, of course, that's been plaguing me for the last 2 weeks. Of course I need to write a song about that.
And get it out of the system.
Yeah. And I find, like, if I do try and write a song that's very specific about something, I'm disconnected with it, and it doesn't really move to the next stage for me.
So you all do it like that lyrically, like...
Yeah, that's so funny. That's really similar to... I find, like, with my personal writing, it's always been something literally that's just kind of come to me when I'm walking, especially. I just get, like,
see,
ideas.
I told you, a walk around the park.
And, yeah, and it'll be always connected to something, like, that's happened or that I've gone through. And sometimes, like, if I'm ready to, like, face up to something, like, that sounds very, you know, but it is. It's been very, like, connected with my well-being, I guess, and it allows me to, like, process things that I'm feeling, which I'm super grateful for, because I, like, don't know where it's come from, and I hope it doesn't go anywhere, but, like, it just seems to happen that way, and I'll just get one line, and it could be, yeah, like, a verse or a chorus, or just, like, one line. It'll make me realize, like, what that song is about, exactly what
that's
you're saying.
That's so sick, hearing that you're saying, like, a really similar thing.
Yeah,
I find
crazy.
It's so interesting hearing what other lyricists do.
Yeah, because it's definitely not this academic formula where I'm like, all right, like, it's got to be in the key of this because I did the last song in the key of this. Like, it's definitely not like that.
Yeah. I, it's different also. It's interesting hearing you guys say that, and I was thinking, for myself, I feel like, I know it's like... the got to be masculine thing and rah, rah, rah. And you sort of, you hide a lot of stuff when you first start writing.
Mm.
And where you guys seem to be much more, being able to be more vulnerable more quickly with those sort of things. And then I wish I could do that because I go rah, rah. But at the end of the day, we all come around to the same thing where it's like you want to express something and sometimes you don't realize you're allowing yourself to express until you, after you look back and you look at what you've written, you're like, oh God, that's a bit, like coming off breakups, it's a classic.
My dad listened to our first album recently.
Yeah.
Fuck. He called me up and we were like having a conversation. He's like, oh, I just listened to your first album and I just completely understand everything now.
And you're like, well, it's good that you do.
Your body was
like,
changing.
Oh, cool. My body was changing.
Do you leave some stuff in the suburbs? Like,
really
do you want to go get it? Like,
we do live in separate houses.
So you and I had this long, you know, interesting conversation about songwriting a couple of weeks ago now.
Uh-huh.
And you said one thing that I absolutely loved, right?
Oh, God.
Yeah, so the next question's about kicking things off musically. Like, what do you do to kick things off musically? And Joel told me about a trick that he has where he plays half of a song and then pauses it.
Yeah.
And then you explain the rest of it.
All right. If you've ever... This is an interesting... Well, I'm not sure if I'm going to tell you the same thing I told you then because that was at least 3 weeks ago. But there's an interesting thing where if you ever get a song stuck in your head, it's because you've only heard a snippet of it. and your mind will replay that again and again until it has completion. So if you ever have a song stuck in your head, go listen to the whole song from start to finish and it'll be done, which is just, of course, every time you've had a song stuck in your head, it's only a little bit. But what I found too, especially the way my band works is the guitarist Ben in my band will write a bed for a track and he'll write something, you know, just chords, and he has an idea of melody. He'll send it to me. I'll mute everything that has anything to do with melody that he's gone, oh, this is a great idea. And I go, I don't care. Just give me what you've done. Because if I hear his melody, like Nick's saying, if you hear anything from his, I'll take that on board and that'll become part of the song. And sometimes it's good and sometimes it's not. But I found that I mute everything that he's done and then I'll listen to just a little skerrick of it and then turn it off and then walk somewhere. Maybe around a park, I don't know.
Walking.
Maybe around, okay. You we never can stop this now, guys. Just go for a walk. Songs are done. Finished.
Nothing bad ever comes out of a walk.
Yeah, yeah. But it's interesting how if you can hear just a little skerrick of it, I don't know if it's just me, but sometimes that gives me enough space to be able to think of the next thing that'll be rather than listening to something through and starting to pile layers on myself. Oh, my God. And the longer the song goes and you haven't thought of anything and you go, oh, my God, I'm so uncreative. This is terrible. And then you, yeah, and oh no, this sounds like Audio Slave. who are great. yeah, anyway, that's a little trick. Try that. See cool. if it works.
I want Greg to talk about.
Yeah, something like that. Yeah. Pretty close, yeah.
Greg is like such a whiz to me at coming up with.
It's all about the music, right?
The music yeah. side of things. Yes. You know, you just build everything and it's phenomenal. Talk.
The process of it.
Like, do you start? What I was kind of meaning was like,
Subbed
do
in.
You start with like a riff? Do you start with like a beat? Is this yeah. something that you work off?
Most of the time, I mean, like my main instrument is and always has been guitar. And I don't know the answer, really. It's like I kind of sit there, and I guess what I've realized over time is that you cannot force it. That's for sure, especially if you're trying to, like, you know, yeah, just trying to find the kernel of a riff. You just got to play enough, I guess, and sit there and be ready to be able to record it. It's a process that I have because I'm also an engineer. So it's like I love being able to go, cool, I'm just going to record that little thing and then work from there. But in saying that, it doesn't always work. I think that's the thing that I've found is that over the years is that I used to just sit there and kind of you just, you know, kind of beating your head against the wall and going, I can't play guitar. Like I've written that song like 10,000 times. I'm sure everyone's maybe had that experience where you're like, I can't break out of this pattern.
But isn't it funny? Sometimes that pattern is you write a great song and it's exactly that pattern. It's just you're in a different mood or you have inspiration.
Yeah.
You're just like, oh, this is amazing. And it's those same three chords.
And how
you just played it with a different intent.
There are only a certain amount of chord progressions and someone will come along. It's like, there's this new band on the scene. It's like the classic four chord structure and they've just like come in with this energy and the lyrics are sick and it's just like a really rad song and it just recreates that. Thing, which is really cool, and I think that's like, I know this is a very, you know, mainstream choice, but I feel like Dave Grohl is somebody from when I was a child that manages to get that in a nutshell. Like every song is basically a banger, but it's just structured. It's pretty much, you know, verse, chorus, and stuff. But like the lyrics are good, and the riffs are amazing, and the hooks aren't predictable, but they're still quite easy and like basic, like,
but it
and
still falls under that same like similar form or you know, four chord structure.
Let's talk about form, right? So, you know, pop songs generally speaking, verse chorus bridge,
love
double
it.
Chorus, right?
Yeah, love it.
Or Bon Jovi section.
Bon Jovi section.
I love the Bon Jovi, like the
whoa.
Yeah, hell yeah.
Nah, like the chorus with like just like you strip everything else out.
Oh, right.
That's what you do before the last chorus, I
reckon. In that form.
I reckon form for me is like the hardest thing because there is like
you guys do some pretty abstract forms,
but
like,
yeah,
I mean, it works.
I think that's because like you know you have this verse chorus bridge chorus structure, and like if you happen to write a song and you fall into that form, you kind of freak out and you're just like, fuck, it's the same form. Every single song has the same form. What do we do?
And every song's in E.
Yeah.
don't listen to our records and check what. Yeah.
I'm just thinking again. It's really funny to be in the situation where you're writing in two very different bands and I feel like Clowns, we will try to rearrange. We'll go out of our way to make it different and exciting and not boring. Whereas when I do stuff, I kind of sometimes I'll write something and I don't necessarily like it, but it's the way it's come out. And I'm like, I can't change it. And I'll try heaps of times. And then it grows on me. I'm like, oh, I really like that song now.
That's a really interesting thing, which I think is really similar to me as well. That once I've written a song, if I've done it on my own and I've written something, to change that structure of it, it just becomes the most difficult thing. But with the band, we've got four people in the room. We're always so willing to just all right, let's try this thing, try this, try this. And we try everything, by the way. That's probably something that's a good tip. You know when you're in a room with people and someone comes up with an idea and then someone else comes up with an idea and you're it can get really overwhelming and then maybe you only try one of them and then you just go oh yeah, that, fine.
Yeah.
Always go back to make sure every single idea is heard. And it totally. Might be the That's smallest so change. It might be the smallest change.
And it can just change the whole thing.
It makes a huge difference. Yeah. Even if you hear it and you go, nah.
And that's what...
That's fine.
You know why it's important to get the time. When we're writing, we at least do it twice a week and it can get really grueling, but it's so important to just keep seeing each other and keep going over it. And then we'll be stuck on something for weeks and it'll be fucking track two on side one. It's oh my God, this song. And it's what are we going to do? And then I just remember this moment we were sitting on the ground and Jared got the guitar or something and just changed this one riff. And then we took a riff from another song we weren't going to use and just put them together. And we were oh my God.
We did
that's
it.
And it's the best feeling.
That's the thing too. Isn't it? We were talking before about how you write songs and whether it's do you just wait for inspiration to strike or do you work really hard at it? And I think you can start a song like that, but once you've got a song kind of up off the ground, you've got to work at it.
You've
got
to just,
try different things and just keep going until you find that little piece. We've had experiences
and
where
if
it's
you
like just that last little bit.
And deadlines can be really good for that reason.
Totally.
you're like, oh no, self-imposed. But then once you are in that crunch, you're like, it just can come out really, really well.
True.
And you were saying, you make sure it's really regular meetups, a couple of times a week.
Mm.
I think that's when you are doing that, making those little tiny changes, those things that can feel so grueling, they become so quick and so natural. You develop this language with your band members that is just all right, we've done that. And all of a sudden you've tried all of these four ideas or something within the space of 2 minutes.
It doesn't
have to take a really long time if you've got this language and understanding with each other.
And you're all willing to try it too.
You've
got to be so
open.
Much compromise just to go.
Always
okay.
be open. Try everything.
This, we'll try.
So one of the things that, I've had experience with you and I know that you guys do as well, obviously, is just recording demos all the time, right? And then chopping up parts of the demos, rearranging it can be hugely beneficial. Which brings me to the next question, which I've thought of as the Coleman's music question, considering where we are. Do you find technology or gear to be an important part of your songwriting? And is there a piece of kit that is integral to your work?
I got a quick answer.
Yeah.
The less technology for us, the better. We get stuck on pedals and we get stuck on plugins and we get stuck on all these sorts of things.
Are you going to have to leave now?
Yeah. That's the no, no. Answer. You just
You're
come in here and
place.
Choose wisely.
The contract
consult.
Is void.
Yeah, yeah. But no, that's a natural progression to get stuck on pedals. You just go through that. But you do that in your own time when you're working together. People just go, all right, you got DS1, that's it. And what bit of equipment?
Yeah,
because
I was thinking about the importance for me of an iPhone.
iPhone and a guitar case?
Yeah. Which is kind of ridiculous. But, do you guys experience that as well?
Oh, yeah. Recording, being able to do more than just a voice memo on your phone and having something, even, you know, garage band or whatever.
Yeah, garage band's great.
It's just so amazing because you build them things. Yeah, and like you just get in, like for me, I'll like be in my room and just like listening over and over and just mulling it over, and I have to get into that weird zone, and it's like people probably like can't talk to me, I can't focus, and I'm just like, oh, and I'm like thinking about lyrics, and like it's so beneficial, and I'm just like demoing in real time almost, like,
yeah,
because you can just keep changing it.
Yeah, I think with like if you're writing on your own and you don't have that full band where it's like four minds together, you can work on things without you know, without some gear or something in front of you. But like solo writing or like writing in a room with yourself, I find it very beneficial to have some sort of program, like
even just voice
Ableton
moment.
Or GarageBand or like Pro Tools, you know, just to be able to build things. Like if you've got, you know, I can't really do two things at once very often. So like for me to be able to put some chords down and then like do the next part is pretty integral for for me writing solo.
When I recorded like the EPs that I have, I did all of that like on the spot because I'd only ever heard like the arrangements in my head because I didn't have anything to record, which is my fault. It took me way too long. But
there's only so much you can store in your head though.
Exactly. So it was like I didn't have enough time to get it all out, but that's why, you know, and you go back over, you're like, fuck, I could have changed that, and then like you want to be happy with something because you're going to listen to that forever.
Yeah. Like, so I wanted to talk about some of the obstacles.
Like, before you go to that, you wanted someone to talk about gear, and you're literally you've got lack of the gear. Yeah, the gear head right here, it's and you almost skipped over him.
We'll be here till 10 o'clock if you get me started.
we also have a dedicated video on the Coleman's YouTube channel now to Greg's gear addiction. So
Greg's gear addiction.
I will speak on that for a second, I guess, is that most people here have access to probably, presumably, some kind of computer, and it's never been easier or cheaper to be able to have a recording interface and software. Like, it's so accessible. If you're a songwriter, it's like probably the most useful tool you can have is to be able to record something that's not just an iPhone demo. It's like something that's actually gonna, like, you listen to it back and you go, like, that's gonna inspire you to then work on that more. I think that's really important. Like, once you get away from that, just like you and your guitar and your voice with an iPhone, that's fine, and it's really useful for getting something down and not forgetting it. But if you can build upon something and go, I'm going to actually record that a little bit better, get it sounding kind of cool, the next time you go back to it, you'll be like, that's sick, and I really genuinely am inspired to work on that more. So I think that's, it's just endlessly useful.
And just to elaborate on what I was banging on about before, Greg's done a rig rundown style thing of his pedal board, which is really interesting, that we're going to put up on our YouTube channel in a couple of days, so worth checking out as well. So I wanted to talk about obstacles, right, with songwriting, and, you know, overcoming, you know, block, self-doubt, comparing yourself to others. What's the trick? What's the trick? Does everyone experience that?
Yeah.
The pain.
Oh my God. I would say the biggest thing for me is to have people I trust that I'm working with, because like if I start getting into a big mental block, it starts.
Is this a mental block? It's happening right now, is it? Holy shit!
Hang on, I'll help her out.
I dreamt about
help
this day.
Out, Greg. You know, like I don't know. I feel extremely fortunate that I have the band members that I do, and they're all incredibly
supportive.
Thank you of me and my feelings. And I reckon there's been a number of times that I've just like broken down in a rehearsal, and it's just like, all right, we need to just like stop with the writing for a second. Stop like pushing shit uphill. And just like have a chat and remember why we actually play music and why we actually write together, you know, and like that's just so getting massive. Back on the same page with a fucking conversation. I feel like that's the thing that would get me through a writing block and a
we
break.
Did that the other night.
Who cried?
Me.
Yeah.
But I always cry though.
And you've got incredibly supportive bandmates who are okay with a little.
I would say exactly that. That's so true. Like, you, if you're playing in a band and you're trying to go for something, you're trying to build your audience, you're trying to get on the radio, you're trying to make something even just sound like your favorite band. It's like there's so many obstacles in the way of you getting there, whether it's the access to gear that you have, the money, the budget that you have, where your chops are at the moment. Just talking to the people who you're playing with, and we talk about this all the time, it's like we're so lucky to be able to even just have these instruments and play these songs together with these people and have this time that just enjoy it to start with. And that seems to reset things, and you go back in and go, all right, fuck, it's good to be out here tonight, you know, just having a smash and having a good time, and then see what comes from that. And so many times it's the intent that comes from that actually makes something special.
I think it's also really good to talk to people outside of the people you're playing with.
Yeah, and they're like, I'm at home tonight, just like, yeah, just watching Gogglebox or whatever else. And you're like, I was at rehearsal and they go, oh, you play in a band.
Yeah,
I do play in a band.
But like, inter-band collaboration has been something that I've always really loved doing. Ooh. And like, even just talking to you guys about music right now is like super
inspiring.
I'm
really inspired to go and write songs. Conversations are awesome.
Pass us those guitars.
Let's write a song right now.
I think that thing you said about like comparison is a common thing that I've personally battled with, is that you kind of, it's so easy to go like, oh, there's something else out there, and that's like you like put this own self-doubt on yourself, and that is a hard thing to overcome. It's like, well, why aren't we doing this? Like, why is that person getting gigs? Why do our songs not stack up? Like, that's really hard to overcome. And I think, I don't know how, I don't know, have you dealt with that before? Like, have you guys felt like that? You know, where you
every single day. Even when something great happens to you, it's not as great as the thing that's happening to the person next to you.
Yeah.
That's the only way you're looking at it.
Putting yourself on like on a pedestal with other bands that you that are quite similar to you, like, but then, you know, maybe their progression is different and you're just like, fuck you guys. But then you're just like, fuck, you gotta not do that. Don't do that. Honestly, just support everyone. Yeah, support everyone. Yeah. I feel like we're all in pretty like supportive group bands.
Yeah. The music industry in its own way, maybe not on purpose, tends to force bands to do that to each other. But it's manufactured. It's not a real thing. And if you go and talk to your peers in other bands, you realize that everyone's just doing the same thing. They just want to play music.
And everyone's got the same insecurities. Yeah, which we're totally. Clearly really
everyone thinks they're doing crap.
In this touring bands, you understand each other and how like hard you're working on that level. And I think it's just a good philosophy to have generally in life. It's exactly the same thing. As soon as you find yourself comparing to anybody else, you just got to like stop because if you like start putting like your credibility or like the worth of your work in like the hands of other people, like with their opinions and start doing that, it just kind of, I think it shows in the music straight away, like in the integrity of the everything that comes across. Like if you're doing it purely for money or to...
It's kind of treated as a bit of a sport in this country in a lot of ways, with like the hottest 100 and things like that, you know, going around. And I feel like there is a lot of competition involved in music, which, you know, stifles creativity.
It doesn't have its place in a creative pursuit to be competitive. It doesn't make any sense to me.
It contradicts art, really, the industry to me. It's so sharky and horrible. And I think it's gotten a lot better, like, you know, since the 50s and shit, where, like, artists are more in control. They're managing themselves. And social media has made that a lot better as well. But, yeah, I think it's, like, same with the writer's block thing. In my opinion, I think if you just keep doing it, like I said, if you keep meeting up every week, there's been weeks where we have struggled like with something and it doesn't get better and we're like, fuck, like, and some of us are just like, what are we going to do? And then it just comes, like, if you keep trying, it's going to come sooner or later. And like, my dad's a songwriter and stuff, and when I've had personally just like, I'll call him and like be dramatic and be like, it's gone, Dad, I just can't write anymore. Like, it's been 3 months, like, I can't do it. And he's like, it always comes back. And like, I just remember that because it does. Like, suddenly you're like written 3 fucking bangers and you're like, hell yeah. Like,
it always happens like that as well. You're like, I'm fucked. My life is over.
Yeah.
And then you're like, I got the 3 best like songs filled with awesome lyrics out of the last 1 week or something. That happened in September, I reckon. I reckon I got super after that little lockdown, or maybe during that little 5 day banger.
Yeah,
5 day banger.
Is that not what everyone else calls it?
I feel like I felt incredibly self-conscious that I wasn't being creative over isolation, because I felt like it was the obvious thing to do, and that all came back down to, oh my God, utilize the time, like look like you're working really hard. And I live with like my bandmates, and they're very productive people, and we're very different people, but like I love chilling. Anyway, I really used isolation for like personal, just like we'd been touring a lot and it was really good for me to have a break, and I let myself enjoy it. And then I did end up writing quite a bit, you know, really in the scheme of things. But it was just, you know, it just comes when it comes sometimes, and forcing it doesn't help anything.
I just wanted to plug this book that I bought recently. It's by Jeff Tweedy. From Wilco.
Do they sell it here?
No. But I just brought this in from home. But it's called How to Write One Song. And there's a whole bunch of shit on all of that in here, and some ideas to get out of writer's block. So everyone go and buy that, because it's a scary thing, as you just stated. Yeah. So one of the things that is mentioned in that book is there's a section called "Don't Be Yourself," which I really liked the idea of. Do you always write from your perspectives, or do you ever take on the character of somebody else and write from a third party perspective? And is that easier?
Fantastic question.
Thank you very much.
Wonderful
question.
I want to hear your answer.
For our first album, or maybe it was second, I can't remember. For one of our albums, I very specifically, I think because maybe we were writing like, we wrote like 40 songs or whatever in the space of a few months. So like I needed to get some sort of inspiration somewhere. I found it super helpful to like, I was talking to friends and just like talking about some of their experiences, and I wrote a lot of songs about friends and their experiences. From my perspective, sounded like it was my experience. Wasn't. I mean,
So this is a dangerous area of songwriting. It can be a really dangerous thing. Al gave me a little anecdote about, what was it? You worked at a radio station?
Yeah.
Yeah, so, and this person came in, a musician, and they had a new song coming out, and it was from the perspective of a refugee in a refugee camp, and they were not a refugee in a refugee camp. And it was like naff as fuck, to use your words. So where is the line, you know, in that, like...
Yeah.
That's a difficult thing.
I mean, I was mostly talking to my girlfriends and a lot of their like experiences, mostly with just like general everyday shit going.
Yeah.
That we've been going through as women.
Yeah, yeah.
One of them was a friend at a New Year's party, and everyone was just asking her, oh, have you got a boyfriend yet? Have you got like a, you know, you're not married yet? You don't have a baby yet? She's like, why is this a thing? Why do I like have to endure this at a family New Year's party or something?
Yeah.
Can't remember what song that was. Sorry, I've gone so off topic.
No way.
But, yeah, I mean, like, I write about that, but then it takes its own form with me in that I relate it to another experience that I've had, and I kind of bring those two things together.
Awesome. That's good.
Okay, move on from me.
That's good. No, I really like that.
Yeah, it's cool.
I often personally find it way easier to write about things outside of myself, because that's scary to write about yourself, you know. And sometimes that can just be the thing that opens the floodgates for a whole bunch of other stuff, and then you've written that one song and then you're like, oh, now I can write all these other ones and I feel way better about it. Mm.
Also, if you focus too deeply on just yourself, it can feel a bit insular and you can just write about the same thing a lot, which is what I've definitely done in the past.
Yeah.
And so a lot of people talk about writing about yourself being therapy and I can get through my emotions and that sort of stuff. I think that's true sometimes, but it's a very hard thing to face up to straight away. I found personally sometimes I don't want to say what I'm feeling. You know, I want to write the voice of somebody else in how I'd like to say what I think of that person or what happened if I was a bit more outgoing or a bit more, you know, belligerent in my delivery of things. And that, I go, okay, I'll take on this character. But it's not writing about somebody else. It's just pretending I've hired someone else to say what I really want to say and through their voice. But it's funny because, and you'll say general shit and then eventually in that voice, and you'll, like I said before, you look back on what you've written once you put yourself in this persona of like, ugh. I go into my bathroom and do demos because it's got good reverb and just because my neighbors hate me. But in there, I'm like looking in the mirror and pretending to be someone yelling at myself. But then you look back at what you've written and it's all kind of, it's shadow, I don't know, shadow play with yourself, but it's sort of, it's you in those lyrics. Yeah. But sometimes you just need to find a way, maybe it's just my own obstacle of getting into character. But you're not, you are singing from someone else's point of view, but it's actually just you.
Yeah, you know, I've definitely done that in the past where it's like, writing from a different perspective, getting some of that deep just, shit out.
Yeah, the rude stuff that you'd be like, oh God. Couldn't possibly say that.
Is there a song that you've written that you feel connects with other people more than others? And what would you put this connection down to? I'm getting pretty serious over here. I'm sorry about that.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. I notice it can be a myriad of reasons, like why people... Because my songs are super personal, so it kind of... people come to me and they're like, I came here for a punk show and I did not expect that. And they'll be crying. They're like, I didn't... Fuck you. I didn't come here to cry. But it's... My mom's, you know, has cancer right now and that really helped me and I needed to fuck it. Like, a really special... stories and like reasons why people have come up to me, which isn't easy also for them to to do. So it's like I just blanked on where that started.
So easy
sorry.
To blank so that's when kind you're of, talking that's a personal lyrical stuff. Thing,
right? Definitely, yeah. And I think when I get lyrics in my brain head, it usually like has a melody to it, so that's where the riff will come from in my song. So usually it is like emotive, kind of, you know, B minor is like my favorite chord. I just always end up going back there and I'm teaching someone my song, I'm like, yeah, it's B minor again, yeah anyway. Mm-hmm. They're like, this sounds like the other one, but yeah all right. But yeah, so I think all of that combined, you know, I love when I hear a pop song that's really upbeat, but it's really depressing. I think that's really clever. But a lot of my songs, like the the mood is quite, you know, emotive. So I think that gets people too, and it's the whole thing. And yeah, I find one song in particular that's very, like when I wrote it, I'm like, that's just really blatant because it's just saying what I felt and it wasn't masked or metaphoric. But that one in particular, people have come up and just been like, that really speaks to me. So I find that interesting that it's the very just obvious one. And it's pointed out how many people like just struggle with depression because they come up to me a lot at the shows. And
yeah,
it's nice.
Interesting. Can you think of a musical moment? I was watching the Clowns footage the other day, actually, from the show at 170 Russell.
Yeah.
And there's musical moments in that, which obviously, you know, inspires people to act as one and do circle pit style scenarios or, you know, or whatever. Like, is there a musical moment that you can think of in any of your songs that, you know, joins people together that isn't lyrical?
We have Suburbia. I guess it is lyrical, but it's like a... It's a big... I don't know, I guess at the end of it, it's a big, powerful kind of moment where music cuts out, song goes. It's very, like, crowd, not pleasing. Everyone's doing
unifying.
It together. Unifying. Crowd unifying. I don't know, I think there's something about... I mean, I'm going to go lyrical because that's just my kind of forte, you know?
Yeah.
There's something about lyrics that put people in a specific place or they can picture themselves in a very specific place or area, and they can feel it as and see it and touch it and smell it, like, and it's just listening to a song. I think that's something that
it's like memories or nostalgia or that sort of stuff.
Yeah, yeah. I think also there's a lot of nostalgia.
It's like you're giving what I think is the coolest thing about the whole thing about music is like going to see live music is like some people can't write and they love music but they're not musical themselves and they're like, I don't know how you do it, and like they don't do it. But you, like, you write a song and kind of voice their feelings for them, and that's why they're into, like, that's why I love all the bands I love, you know, I'm super into lyrics and shit. So that's so special for them to be like, you've just kind of like nailed what I feel and I couldn't do it myself, and it just kind of like gets there, and I'm like, yes, because like when I wrote it, that's how I felt when I wrote it. I'm like, yes, I got it. Oh, and like it helps me feel better. So it's like this awesome, like, you're both getting something out of it. And it's beyond both of you. It's just this fucking cool thing that exists when why music is awesome. Like,
and does that connection then make that song like your favorite song in the set?
I like them all for that reason, personally. All my songs are special for that reason. Like, yeah.
Interesting. Mm. All right.
Yeah, there's lots of different things that make different songs great in a set.
Mm. Yeah, fair enough. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. I had a.
Sorry. It's, I certainly don't play 45 minutes of music so that I can get to that one song that like people connect with in
the
a very specific
songs.
Way. Yeah.
Because you love them all.
I don't know. I think that like the interactions that I have with the listeners and the crowd and my bandmates as well throughout an entire set is what makes me play music on a regular basis. You know, like it. That's my fulfillment.
That's beautiful.
Oh, thanks.
There are rad bits where you get to like rock the fuck out and like, you know, we're working on our dancing and sequence thing and like, and I'll just run over and like, you know, kiss Jared on the shoulder or something, like, hey buddy, like run around. So like, there are definitely like middle eights that stand out more than others.
Yeah.
If I'll be honest.
Yeah. Not necessarily the crowd favourite sections, but your favourite middle eight.
Exactly. Yeah.
I'm working
on
my backflip.
This is the part where I get a cuddle.
That's coming in next year.
Right? Yeah, looking forward to that.
From an audience point of view, there's a very clear... I had music teacher once who told me his favourite band was Rammstein, not because he even liked Rammstein or metal or anything like that, but because they were masters at deny and deliver in their songs. So from a songwriting point of view, it's like they have these moments that deny you what you want to hear, and then they deliver, and that deliver is usually like you think of an engine or like a dam breaking or something like that, where the riff rolls out, the drums start, or there's this stripping back in a middle eight that's like denying you of some oxygen that you need, and there's that stop and then bang back in. So
that's beautiful.
That sort of like, well,
yeah,
just
everyone take out your phone and write that down.
Deny and deliver.
But then you
deny
listen to
deliver.
You listen to every Rammstein song and from there, and it's exactly the same, but fuck, they've nailed it. It's just like, bang and in, and it just builds and drops. Like what you were saying about Dave Grohl before.
It's really similar to another thing that I heard that I really liked, which is like a pattern disruption, where it's like the brain is so good and used to hearing patterns. And so if you can then, you know, set up a groove or something like that, or something, you go like, oh, there's an expectation there, and then find the right time to then go, no, we're going away from that and doing something that you don't expect. You're just going to draw the listener in every time. Like, I think that's it's a very similar device, but it's like, it goes along with it. And it doesn't work for every style of music, obviously, but I mean, listen to any dance music, house music, techno or anything like that. They are like, that is what that music is all about.
Yeah, that's the same thing with like lyric writing as well. Like, you know, there's the expectation of a pattern, but if you have that pattern going throughout the entire song, like the similar form, like 1-2, 1-2, like same, too difficult to describe, then it can get so boring. But if you like throw it off by like, instead of having a rhyming word, do the opposite, you know, the meaning of that word, but throw in a different, like it doesn't rhyme, you know, that's a, and there's so many little things like that, that the brain kind of expects something, but you throw it off by not finishing in the same way, or like not starting.
Compare, like the second verse compared to the first verse. Sort of
yeah.
Thing. Like
yeah.
You throw some flourish in there that makes Yeah, I think that's all the same stuff. Like that's that Max Martin shit coming in. Yeah. It's just like,
and when there's like thought, a lot of thought and care behind something like that, I think that's what people are hearing. Like when you give a shit about something like that much, it really comes through and people are like, oh, they've like, you know, really, that's really clever, like that thing that, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You just said something that made me feel like I needed to highlight it. Giving a shit about your music and what you're doing, I think, is so fucking important.
Yeah.
If like, why are you doing it? You're doing it because you love being creative. You love like building something from wherever to this point. And if you don't love and enjoy every moment of that and just, I mean, like it can be fucking hard sometimes, don't get me wrong, but like don't get distracted by other things. Don't get distracted by like what the current trends are or like what you think someone else is going to listen to and like go, oh, I'm not going to like they won't like that lyric or they won't like that that type of thing. Like just bring it back to loving what you're doing.
Yeah.
And that will always shine through in your songwriting and your songs.
Yeah. I'm just going to steer it slightly away from the spiritual aspect for a second because that was really beautiful.
How dare you?
It was nice, but I just want to go down a slightly more practical route with this question. Yeah. Which is your favorite pedal? Yeah. I've been having a lot of conversations about songwriting lately, and something that comes up a lot is the space that you're in when you do it. How important is it to you to have a writing area, and what does that look like?
Mine's just in my apartment, which is all one room, so it's everything, and I found that kind of tricky.
Is your bed in the same room as your lounge room?
And my fridge, and my there's a spa bath in my lounge room too, which is really weird.
Is that called a studio apartment?
It was an old brothel, apparently. Oh. Yeah, it is. Cool. It is.
It's current brothel.
Hey. I got a license. So I know what you mean. Like, I would like a better space, but this is kind of the space that I have. And like we were talking about before, where it's like, do you wait for inspiration to strike or create, put mood lighting on and stuff like that? I sometimes find that if I try to create a space too much, then I feel conceited in the space that I've created. Mm-hmm. Just like if you go shopping for clothes and you go, oh, what do I get? And then someone hands you a jacket, friend goes, do you want this jacket because it's cold out? And you put it on and you go, man, I look good in this jacket. And that's all you care about wearing from then on because you don't think about it too much. So I try to not mess with my space too much. Just go, that's what I've got.
Yeah.
And not think about it as being an integral part for what I'm trying to do. Just look at the screen and drink the scotch.
So this is really interesting because I know that you guys have this beautiful little studio set up, which is Greg's studio, Lunchroom Records. And that seems to be playing a big part in your new record.
Yeah, I mean, it's really nice to and fortunate to have a place where we can meet up twice a week, three times a week, and it's kind of ready to go. And that was it's great. It's just like it's there. You jump on. It doesn't take like half an hour of loading in and setting shit up, and we can just record everything all the time. But it's funny in saying that as a songwriter getting something started. If I go there, if I drive there to write a song, no fucking chance. Like, it will not happen. It's just like, it's got to be immediate. I've just got to like sit on a guitar at home and do it. It's just, doesn't work like that.
I'm the same with like lyric writing. I don't really want a space.
Yeah. Is it that you're not happy when you get there?
I've got a phone to write notes.
It's just like I've gone there with too much intention. It's like, oh, I'm going to go write a song today.
I totally get that.
Doesn't work like that.
Is this thing on?
Yeah.
So awesome to have a space to collaborate in. Like that's, if you can foster an environment like that, like it's, yeah.
I love it. I love my room so much. It's like my favorite place ever. And isolation was awesome because before that I was just like, we were touring so much and I didn't get time to kind of do up my rooms. I just had like a bed and a desk and I was like, yeah, I'm getting a rug and I'm going to like, and now I've got fairy lights in there. And now that I can record in there, I can like turn all the lights off and just have it in the darkness and just light candles and totally get in the zone. And Stevie's like, please be careful with the candles, please. All right. But yeah, it's awesome. I think it's so important to have a space. And like, I get what you mean. Like, when I overthink anything, it just stunts it for me. So if I'm like, I'm going to go there and I'm going to go to the park and like get a book out and like write some lyrics, so that will never happen for me. So I'll just be walking somewhere and I'll be like, oh, and like I was on my way to work running through the servo and I just got this like line. I was like, oh, I'm going to like, I know I'll forget this, but it, like, luckily it stayed. But yeah, so, but then I'll, you know, when I'm recording now in my room, like, I'll write lyrics on the spot because I've got ideas just shooting off, and it's like having that cool space, and like, the, if I've got shit everywhere, it's like it just clutters my brain, like, so I have to have it clean and stuff.
I asked this question about space to a friend of mine recently, and she took it on as being about like space within her life. And she was saying, like, you know, oh yeah, it's so important to make space for music within your life. So, you know, you all have day jobs, right? And like, you know, you do various things.
Correct.
No? Okay.
A weekend job.
Yeah.
It's complicated.
For now.
So like, so how do you juggle, you know, time? Like, and touring, is, so touring is the same thing.
Yeah. Oh yeah, when you work, like I have worked full time. it's so hard. Like, you'll be like, at work, it's the most frustrating thing when you're like, riff in the phone, you're like, I'm getting at home, like, work on this, and you get home and you're just so exhausted and you're like, I don't feel like playing, and then you're like, I never get time for this, I hate my job, blah, blah, blah. It'd be really depressing. So I think they're totally right, like, you need to somehow make time some way, like, somehow.
Yeah.
You just got to. Mm.
Well, we've definitely, over the years, just had to go, like, this is, like, we're doing it, like, well, I think it just started off, it's like Wednesdays, like everyone clear their Wednesday night, that's it. We got like, you have to do it. And if you just, if you show up every week, week after week, it'll you'll get shit done. Like, you've dedicated that time to it and you know that you've done that. So, and the hardest thing can be juggling four or five members.
Oh, my God, yeah.
Oh, God.
In a strange way, when you make that space for it too, like, you don't need to get anything done, just make the space and go. Like, you go to rehearsal and it sucks and you come away with nothing. See you next week.
It's never like, nothing. It's never for nothing.
Like, no, it isn't.
Even if you feel like you've just done fuck all for 4 hours, it's never for nothing. Like, the fact that you got there into that room and you did that. What? The fact that you got into that room together is like, it's everything. Like,
it's very encouraging. Thank you.
Don't ever think that
you guys are getting the most from
that.
This. So.
Oh my God, I'm going to write so many songs when I go home.
You raise a really good point just then. When, if you ever, like, talking, every time I've like learned something about music, like, this happens to me all the time, mainly, funnily enough, like, just with Pro Tools or like something audio engineering wise, but I think it applies to songwriting as well. Collaborate with everyone else that you can, like, any, and like, it's funny with audio engineering, it's very solitary. So I'll go into another studio sometimes, I'll watch someone do something and be like, what the fuck, what did you just do then? Like, and that will completely change my workflow. But I think the same would apply for songwriting. It's like what we're doing, all of us right now, like in a room, that's, we're going to come away with some serious ideas from this, I think.
You got to sit down and have a board meeting with all of your creative people and just talk. Just talk creativity and, like, what is your process? Like, it's so I've been finding it so interesting to hear, like, your two processes and, like, you know, the similarities but the differences. Yeah.
It's really easy to get a musician talking about their process
themselves.
You know, horrible.
Like, you know, they love talking about it. Everyone, like,
my process. It's well, I'm just like,
So if you like, if you want, you just totally reach out to musicians that you know and just be like, you know, I'm writing songs, I'm learning, I really like your songs. How the fuck you do that shit?
Yeah.
We've had people message us through Instagram and Facebook and whatnot, and just chat about that. And I love talking to people about it. You know, I've made a really good friend in Brisbane over the last couple of years. That just from that, he just reached out and was like, hey man, I really like your guitar tone. How do you do it? And like, what pedals do you use? And then from there, it spurred on like a whole friendship where, you know, I've produced records for him. He sends me stuff all the time. And those kind of relationships are super, super useful for both him and myself. Like, I've got a lot out of it personally. But yeah, I think that like, people are totally open to that. I don't think there'd be, unless like people are just super busy, but
like moody Nick Cave types.
Yeah. Maybe, like, yeah, they might. But they'll just tell you to fuck off.
Yeah, I think you'd be surprised what, you know, all your favourite musicians and the people you think are in big bands and all that stuff, they probably have exactly the same things we're talking about, where it's just like, we suck, or we're great, and then we suck again, and this pedal, and then someone goes, hey, what's that pedal you see? Oh, this pedal I got here? Well, let me tell you. Someone's interested. I'm getting positive reinforcement about this, you know, so it's yeah, always true. Worth asking the question, because I'm sure they're just like, yeah, I'd love to talk.
So has anyone got the time? What's the time,
Tim? It's 7:05. 7.
All right, I got one last question for you, and then maybe if anyone else wants to ask a question, then we'll wrap. Last question, and it's one, you know, it's a pretty obvious one, but if you could go back to the start of your career as a musician and give your younger self one piece of advice in regards to songwriting or being a musician in general, what would that piece of advice be?
Cute question.
It's a super cute question.
Thanks.
I don't know if I would give myself, I don't know if I would necessarily give myself advice, but like,
don't do it, kid. Get out while you still can.
Study hard.
Don't jump on that thing of that show in 6 years' time and fuck your lumbar up.
But I would like go back and tell myself to do some of the things that I did that I find that might have been like invaluable for my progression throughout the years. And like when I was first getting into the music industry as a young person, I was like, I just immersed myself in music, and I went to so many gigs and I met so many people, and I found it so invaluable to meet people and understand, like, understanding, like, behind the music industry or behind the music in so many different places. And I was so curious and I was so, like, excited and excitable. And I feel very grateful for that young self of me. That I did those things.
Yeah.
I don't want to do them now. I don't want to go out and meet people and like socialize with strangers all the time in the music industry. But I'm really grateful that I did that when I was young and excitable.
Mean.
Because I learned so much. Yeah. I learned so much, and every single day I got like inspiration to do something, whether it was to write songs or whether it was to fucking write a press release for the band I was in, or like, or do my taxes.
What?
Like
that happened once.
Back on track.
You know, like just going out and talking to so many people in different fucking areas of music and just being inspired by every single person around me.
Yeah.
I think that was a really invaluable thing that I did as a younger person.
Mm. All right.
And I don't do my taxes now. No, I do. I'm behind, though.
Yeah, me too, actually. Anyway.
You'd think that with, like, however many months of lockdown that we'd be able to catch up a bit.
Nah. Fuck 'em. I would say listen to as much music as possible that is not exactly the sort of stuff that you listen to. I think we're talking tonight about roadblocks and about overcoming your own, you know, thoughts about things or how to get outside of yourself or where to get around this song and how you learn about stuff. I think when I think about how I write songs now, I'm really thankful that my parents played a lot of different music from a lot of different places to me. So if someone says, what are your influences? You go, well, you know, it's all your parents' music, but then it's like La Bamba and like really cheesy shit as well. And you're like, yeah, that was weird, but it showed you certain things that maybe you should not do. But no, I think listening to a bunch of different music that's outside, and this is not when you're just young, but as you go through life, this, you know, go and listen to folk music and Latin music and fucking grindcore and stuff. And I think that's just as inspiring, you know, stuff that you don't listen to if that's not within your genre. If you are into grindcore, you know, go listen to, you know, Enya and go, oh man, stealing that synth and that wave sound.
Yeah.
But that's, I found that invaluable in writing songs. If I get stuck somewhere, I'll pull something from somewhere weird and try it out, and at least you don't feel so linear and so black and white in what you're trying to portray creatively.
There's no need to pigeonhole yourself.
Yeah, well, and then by definition, you can't pigeonhole yourself because you're just like, well, I don't know. What are your influences? You go, everything. That's a terrible question, but at least when you go to write, you've got a lot of different stuff, and you can start that any time too.
Mm. Hanny, you done?
Hanny or Greg?
Me?
Yeah.
What I'd tell myself?
Yeah.
Yeah. I think it's really important to like not regret anything, and it's like very easy to, and it can be hard. And I feel it's so cool because I feel like my past 17 years of experience, like playing live in pubs, has now, I feel kind of the same, but now I just feel a lot more confident to go on and act the way that I know I can, that I haven't in the past. Like when I was very young, I wasn't confident, you know, and I was 15 kind of dealing with promoters that were 36 or 40 and these huge dudes, you know. And I got like ripped off all the time because I wasn't like, pay me my money. I was just like, hey, mate. And I tried to be like really, you know, like not staunch, but I tried to be taken seriously as a 15-year-old girl, which I wasn't a lot of the time, you know, unfortunately. And it's like, but you just like learn to, I think you've really got to be confident in what you're doing to do that in any regard. But with your music, like you have to, or get people in your team that can ask, you know, for money for you, and like self-respect, it's just really important. So I think if I could, I'd just be like, just try to believe in yourself a bit more, and like, yeah.
You want?
Yeah, it's a tricky question to answer. And those were amazing answers that you all gave. I find it hard to add anything to that. But I guess it's just to like, yeah, go easy on yourself and not criticize yourself so much, you know, potentially is to just... Yeah, like give yourself the space to realize that you're learning all the time. Like you don't need to be somewhere. Like you're not trying to get somewhere. You're on a journey to be a songwriter or be, you know, make the best music you can. And someone once said something to me that like I really have kind of taken away. And it's just like when you're making a record and that like, you know, the self-doubt part of it kicks in, is just to remember that that's just like it's just a timestamp of where you were at the time. So if you go like, you know, go back and listen and go like, oh, I hate that thing that I did, then it's not a healthy relationship to have with your own art.
Exactly, yeah.
I think that's beautiful, having like a timestamp of a specific moment. That I think that's like one of the reason I like to create things sometimes.
That's really good. I wanted to add to that, share more music, because I don't know if you guys are the same, but I feel like I've shelved like the majority of the songs that other people haven't heard. So share as much and, you know, and get feedback on it and like talk to people about that
stuff. Yeah,
but also
like,
don't take feedback from cunts. Fuck. That's one thing I'd go back and tell myself. I take it back. Yeah, I've got one thing to tell myself as a younger person.
So beautiful.
Don't take feedback.
You don't
from a cunt.
Have to get punished. You don't have to stand there for 2 hours and take.
Hey, you're shit. Going really well, but your best friend is so much better than you.
Oh.
Whoa.
Brutal. Yeah. Yeah. Right. That's. Yeah. Don't do that.
There's good. Some nasty parts.
There are some really nasty people out there. Just stay away from them. I'm hoping that like. Throughout the in the future, there'll be less assholes.
Mm. Right, we need an asshole virus.
Yeah,
it'll come. I'm sure. I'll put it in the suggestions box. Does anyone have any questions that they would like to ask any of these guys before we wrap up?
I have one.
Yeah.
I thought maybe to ask if you had any creative routines, to work out the muscles, maybe lyrical muscles or.
I'm going to go and say non-creative routines in that, like keeping healthy and like walking, exercising, eating well, making sure you've got like a well-rounded space, cleaning your house, I think is super important. I don't know if they're necessarily creative things, but they certainly lay a really good groundwork for me to then... be creative on top of that.
Mm. I've got a couple too that would be, if you, like we're talking about having a program to write on, I imagine you all have them or you're now all inspired to get one, but one of my routines is to get on and just write a bunch of things really quickly, just ideas down, and just put them down, just to, like you say, like it's trying to work out. You're not trying to write a hit. I'm just trying to get a groove down. I'm trying to improve my, you know, my skills, kind of setting up songs or getting some pulling sounds really quickly. And the other one lyrically too is to write everything that comes into your head. And I've got a whiteboard marker in my bathroom and a big mirror, and I'll just write whatever comes. Wake up in the morning, I'll just go and write stuff.
I want to see this. Like, so, I want to see
this apartment.
I was wondering what was going on.
I want to be on a fly on the wall in this apartment. Yeah. he's in character, I just, like scribbling on the wall. Like,
it's funny though, because it's not the words that are coming out, it's the feeling that you're putting down. Sometimes I'll take lyrics from there, but a lot of the time I'll just fill it with scribble just to get that venom or that feeling.
Yeah.
Out and rolling, and just like you, sometimes you go, oh, that's great. Other times you have friends come around and you're like,
it's like a technique that was suggested to me that's like, you just get up every morning when you get up, you just write for like 15 minutes.
Yeah, that's a great
and
one.
You just write whatever's there, and you just, yeah, and it can really help the.
I bought a diary recently to do exactly that, which was write a page of absolute nonsense, just stream of consciousness. I haven't touched it once.
I did it 3 times. Like I'm so bad with routine. If I set out to do something like that, I just hate routine, and I like can't trick myself into doing it. I already know the end game, so I'm like, nah. And then I have an 8-minute vocal warm up that I do on YouTube, and that's enough time for me where I don't get bored, and it's good enough, I guess. But like, you know, when I get into writing mode, I'll be honest. You know, it's like wine. Beer, smoking, I get really into it. So that can be, you know, we'll have to deal with that sooner or later. But
so booze.
I can get in a real kind of cavey just mood thing with my stuff. And that can be, I guess, a routine.
You touched on vocal warm-ups. I do like before a show, I do like 5 minutes of breathing exercises and then about a half hour of vocal warm-ups. I guess that is very much a creative routine that I do. And a lot of that is, like, I don't know, I've found myself getting a little bit anxious before shows, but if I do that, it's just like a bit of a meditation thing as well. So
I would suggest, like, definitely pushing yourself to do it. It always makes me feel better when I put the time aside. My anxiety, though, I can just be, like, out the pub, down the road, you know, to get away, to have some time before I play. It can just be the way, and I won't be able to do that. So it's, like, good to try to... It's all part of, like... healthy part of like yeah
it's good. I think there's something about the morning as well. You mentioned getting up in the morning and spending 15 minutes in Jeff Tweedy's book there
funny
he talks about
that.
Morning routines.
You need to stock that here,
and it's the morning is a really good time.
Yeah, it's crazy good.
Yeah. Get to the studio or something, or I was doing it where I'd get there at 6 a.m. like
really
and that's when we mixed our first record. I was like, I'm just going to do this in the morning. And I'd find that I'd get to midday and I'd be like coming out of this fog, I'd be like, what just happened?
Yeah.
And then it's only midday and you go, oh, cool, I kind of go have lunch and then maybe go home. Yeah. Like, and
the rest
of your day.
Of the
yeah.
day.
And your head isn't full of the bullshit of the day.
Yeah,
no.
True.
Yeah.
Yeah. No.
So that's a good one.
On your Tweety.
Yes.
I've got a question. Say you recorded something, you kind of get to the end and record something. How do you stop feeling with it?
You never stop.
This is
you
like
never
the
stop.
Best question for
you never
Greg.
Stop fooling with it until the deadline comes.
You run out of money.
Yeah, you have a deadline.
Yeah.
You have a deadline and you've got to be a bit harsh with yourself and go, like, this is it. This is it. This
you
is
know
a decision.
You're not,
you've got to be really solid on your decisions. Why are you making them?
Yeah.
Just like be really confident
exactly,
in yourself to make whatever decisions
think,
you need to make.
Yeah, and being prepared before, if you're going to go and record something, being prepared, practicing heaps and being prepared and knowing how you want it to feel. But then when you do record quickly and get it, well, personally, I record quickly and get it done and can it and that's it and you walk away and that, you know, if the takes are great.
Capture a moment.
Yeah. Exactly. If you start feeling with, man, I've overbaked so many things by going, oh, wait, what have I added? French horn here.
The mixing process. Yeah.
No, like
also
if you know your shit and you go, I'm sorry?
Also outsourcing, like you're talking about outsourcing. It's like get someone else to curate that process.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah, true. Massive.
Like,
and just go.
That's where you can go, you track it, you walk away and someone else mixes it and you go, cool, man. Like
yeah.
Having the deadline, like it's good because you don't, realize, you can worry about something forever and you don't realize how like good you can be or creative you can be until you put yourself in a position where you have to do something. You're like, well, I'm not going to let this go out with just guitar tracks, am I? And no vocals. Yeah, yeah. We're going to fucking get it done, aren't we? Yeah. So like, if you do it, you're like, all right. And then you try really hard. It's like, I do only have 2 weeks left. And then it does end up being like what it is. And, you know, yeah. So it's good. You just got to do it.
Yeah. One thing I would suggest is to have a really good relationship with yourself, knowing that like what you're capturing is a moment in time. We touched on it earlier, but you don't need to be working on something for a year and continuously changing, because you're constantly changing. Like, yeah. You have to trust yourself and go, the things that I do and create are a picture of a moment in time, and that's perfect. And you should never regret anything. Like, yeah, you could go back and you could do it completely differently, but like, that's beautiful.
So, and you can still do that. That's the cool thing about everything. You can do what the fuck you want to do. And if you want to go back and re-record a whole album as a like electro pop album version, you can.
Fuck yeah.
So it's like, awesome. You realize, hang on, I'm not boxed in. But I mean, it depends. Yeah. If you're in a band, like say that you're a successful band, you've released like, you know, two albums, and then there is a pressure to release something good. So you can't argue about that. So you're like, how do I keep writing originally and doing what I want to do, but I've got this deadline, I've got to please. I feel like I have to please a bunch of people and like sell records. So like, you've just got to, I think, keep real and like, and never do it purely for like other people. But yeah.
And remember
it comes back to loving what you're doing.
Yeah. Yeah. And also that if you don't finish something, you're just holding up the next thing coming out too. So finish it, and then the next thing, you know, it's not like this is the last thing you'll ever do. Mm. It's like you're actually holding up a bunch of maybe super bangers that are coming after that. Just get it done, learn true. Something, holding next one. Holding up the bangers. Hashtag.
There's another question. Yep.
Based on the discussion, I have a feeling that we're talking about music that we're creating for ourselves, what if you're creating it for someone else? Is there any additional like considerations that you have for making music for someone else? And also, in connection with that too, have you ever made music that was originally for yourself, but then at the end you realize, oh, this doesn't work for me, this doesn't work for my voice, for my image, and you feel like it's better suited for someone else, and what do you do with it?
That is a really great question, and I would absolutely love to get into writing for other people, because we have a lot of songs that are like we end up going, this isn't like, it's not quite right for us anymore, or it's not gonna like work, and I feel bad that I don't have a huge amount of advice in this area.
I've got one. There's a website actually that you can send your tracks to. Can't currently remember what it's called, but I'll look it up after this and I'll show you. And it, like, if it doesn't suit your stuff, you can put it up there, and then they use it for sync in commercials or YouTube videos or movies, all sorts of stuff like that. You can also pitch things to different places, publishing, and things like that.
Yeah, get in touch with publishing houses. There's a bunch of good ones in Melbourne itself. Native Tongue's one that springs to mind, but if you've got a catalogue of music that you want to collaborate with people on, get in touch with publishing houses, get in touch with A&R representatives at record labels. Really common thing at the moment, I guess, is people collaborating in that way, where they might have a killer artist that has an awesome voice but doesn't write their own songs, and they're always looking for people to write songs with.
And I think in the first half of that question as well, you were talking about working to a brief. Like, so someone comes to you and is like, I need, this kind of song created.
Like the image when you have to write. Yeah. Your writing style might be different and might not fit for them. So do you have to cater to their image? Do you have to cater to their voice range as well? Things like that.
I would suggest, you can always bump us, like change the key of something. So like, if it's not quite in their range, they can just bump it up or whatever.
Communication is really key on that one.
Definitely. Yeah. If you had like a rocky, like a group, this is completely hypothetical because I don't write for other people either, but like if you had a rock group come to you and be like, we need a song, you'd definitely, cater to that. And they're like, we want a rock song. Yeah. It's this with a sick fucking lead thing in the middle. And you're like, cool. Like, you're going to make it. suit their image, I guess. And if it was like a pop artist that wanted that and they were projecting something, I guess you would cater it and the lyrics to that. And
yeah, I'd do a deep dive on their current songs, figure out what are like key elements, things that are what makes that artist, like specific things that you feel are really important, and then maybe like try and include those sorts of things rather than like go, I'm going to write one of your songs again. Just have like key things that you're working towards.
Or I guess if it's a more of a commercial endeavor, like, you know, writing for ads or sync or something like that, then it'd be communication with whoever's employed you. But yeah, not speaking from someone that knows that world intimately, but I've worked with a couple of guys that do that for a living, and there it just seems like a back and forth communication. It's.
I think that line of communication is a really important thing for a lot of creative areas. Like, I'm a designer, and like I can often like get really like hung up on what I'm doing and be like, oh shit, like this, they're not gonna like this. But if you show it to them and like bring the element of collaboration, you know, earlier on in the piece, make sure you're on the same page. If you're not, then you haven't spent like too much time going down a rabbit hole. You know, they can like pull out the bits that they like really like, you know. I think that communication would always be super key.
Another boring thing to add there as well is like
nothing is ever boring.
Well, storing the songs that you have written in a way that, you know, you can remember where they are is really important, because I used to be in this band with this guy, and he wrote a demo for our band, and then the band broke up, and then he was at a show in New Zealand, and he met this person who worked for Saatchi, and Saatchi, I think, was the company, but they were making a Weet-Bix commercial, and he just had his head tattooed with a friggin' chain, and he was like slightly bleeding and stuff, and I don't know why they just started having this conversation, and she was saying, oh, I've got this band from Australia that's trying to write this song for this Weet-Bix commercial and they suck, and my friend, who's very like outspoken and full on, was like, oh, I've got a song for you, I'll give it to you tomorrow. And she was like, are you serious? And he was like, yeah, I'll just send it over. And he pulled it out of his, you know, well-organized Dropbox and sent it to her.
I thought you were going to say the opposite.
Grand,
yeah. Like, yeah. It wasn't organized. He's like, I'll just get it from my... Oh, my God.
Weet-Bix. Cool.
This is like a fairly... Like, we've just started it feels very clinical to say it, but we have just started a very clinical storage method.
Yeah.
And it's based off of someone that Frank went to for some sort of workshop. This is our drummer, and it's basically splits up your songwriting process into like ideas, like snippets and ideas and stuff, and then songs that you're currently working on and that are in progress, and then another one which is like it goes through a couple of quality controls. Is this like song good enough to move to the next level? Do you want say you're writing an album? Do you want it to be on this album? And if it's no, you never throw out a song. It just moves back into the ideas folder, because you can always come back to this ideas folder and you can always pull a snippet. You might just go back, listen to a few things and be like, fuck, that's the best line I've ever written. How is this not in something that I've released?
Yeah, totally.
That was really energetic of me.
I needed it, so thank you. It's good.
I'm just like, woo! But yeah, I think that's a method that we're currently working on, so that we always have something to work on. You know, we can never be stuck.
It's great.
Yeah.
Any other questions? One down the back.
Is there an album that changed your life and why?
These are always the hardest questions.
I'm usually the worst at answering these questions, but I think I can. Straight up. It's because we've been... Yeah, I know. I said, don't ask me this question. Don't you dare ask me anything about influences and things like that, because, yeah. But...
Thanks for stalling for me while I try to think
about it. My pleasure, babe.
Keep stalling.
when I was in year 9 or something, it was brand new, Deja Entendu. Was a life-changing record for me that I think that I've probably listened to 8,000 times. It was the album that made me want to write songs. It made me think about lyrics. It made me wish they were the words I wrote down. that was a lyric reference. Yeah, but that, before that, I didn't.
You didn't care.
I mean, I cared, but like, I didn't think that it was a possibility for me. But I listened to that album, and it kind of changed for me. And I was like, I do want to be able to, like, I know that I can, and I just like knew that I could write lyrics and I could do it. Probably took me about 5 years before I actually wrote a song after listening to it, but I knew I could and I wanted to from listening to that album.
You worked it out, yeah, Joe?
Well, just from what you inspired in me, that the first time it was AC/DC live in Dresden on cassette in 1980. So, anyway, my dad cool had all these cassettes and I was just randomly picking out things as a six-year-old. You don't know what stuff is. And that was the first thing that, like we were talking about Rammstein before, that sort of deliver, deny sort of shit.
As a six-year-old?
Yeah.
Fuck, I was listening to Britney.
I didn't have any friends. I was just
you didn't
at home
have friends.
Tapes. It was Chris Christopherson. Like, no. You know, Herman's Hermits. No. AC/DC Live in Dresden was like a whole lot of Rosie Live. That sort of stuff where it was just like hit you in the head. And you're like, holy shit. That like that gave me a hard on for music where it's just like, damn, that moves you, you know? Yeah. I think for me, that's the most important thing with why? Really? Sorry? No,
I was kidding.
Okay.
It's fine.
Okay.
We're all friends here now.
But yeah. But it's like something that if you're talking about what inspires you, I think that first time you hear a song that makes you feel, what makes you forget about what we're talking about before with form and structure and all that sort of stuff. It's just like, it's just emotion and pure power and pure. You know, I've always thought about music in terms of like engines or tides or rivers or something where it just doesn't, you know, it's just got power to it. And that could be a hard rock song or it could be a folk song where it just loses you. So anyway, that's mine. So, but maybe you guys have the same feeling.
Hannah, you got one to add?
My one was probably most influential, if I really drill it back, was probably Silverchair, Frog Stomp.
Ooh, yes.
I don't know. It's just like, and just knowing that they were like 16-year-old kids and from Newcastle, and it was just like, I guess I can do that at some point. I can pick up a guitar and
and sound like a 48-year-old man.
Yeah.
Magically.
Yeah. But I mean, that and I guess maybe like the, I mean, just to the age group that we grew up in, like Blink-182 records, it's like makes me want to, you know, you listen to it, you go like, I can play that shit. Like,
totally. I think it's like there's a couple of elements because I grew up with my parents listening to stuff all the time. So I was thinking like, you know, with Joni Mitchell and artists that are really big inspirations for me. I heard them from such a young age. I didn't really have that like light bulb moment with those. I think Stooges' Funhouse was huge for me. It's like when I listen to that now, it's like every time's the first time and it just like grabs you by the throat and just like shakes you around. And it's just like he knew that you know, was going to get him kicked out of places. And it did. And it was like, it's just fucking really cool. And it was kind of that mixture. It's like my favorite kind of vocal where it's like, just a bit of screaming, not too much, but it's just like, you know, got heaps of kick.
I'm with you on that. Any other questions?
Yes. Yeah, it probably relates more to the instruments or production side of things. When writing a song and putting one together, do you sort of pay much attention to how it's going to sound live? Or do you sort of think like, we'll record one way, perform it another?
I'll be quick. We always record for live. Because we're a live band and we need to go, what is this? We always think about, how is this? I mean, that's where we make money, is playing shows and selling T-shirts. But it's and that's also where we have the most fun too, you know. And we're also not good enough to play one way and then play a different way on stage. It's like, what? Just make it civil. Always for live.
Pretty similar, mostly for live. Additional changes sometimes, like if we feel like it needs something or it needs to be slightly different for the record, we have a big discussion. We go, it's okay if it's slightly different. No one's going to fucking notice. So, yeah, mostly for live. But if it calls for it, it calls for it.
Yeah, I think it's fun to, like, make songs work differently live, you know, when you have gone a bit ham in the studio. Like, because, like, we've got a song with, like, sitar on it, and we don't bring a sitar to every show for that one song.
Just the Melbourne
which
shows.
Which would be so sick. But, yeah, we actually did it with a keyboard, though. We, like, carted this little one around for, like, this one song, but it was worth it. But, yeah, I think for me, I've always been a huge, like, when I play, I ideally would like to, if someone's come to pay to see me play, like, I'd like to play them what they've been listening to as much as I can, especially with vocal arrangements, like, harmonies. If you're going to put, like, if I'm going to put three-part harmonies on a song and record that, I want to be able to do it live and make it sound really cool.
Yeah, our three-part layered harmonies don't come very often.
It's hard.
Yeah, it's like, again, if something calls for it, then occasionally a couple of songs get through with a big fucking choir part.
I love you got it. That.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, we do that live, though.
That's three-part.
Yeah. I think for our, like, speaking on our particular sound, I guess, in records, like, we're a one-guitar band. But in the studio, I just, like, kind of can't help myself, and I like the sound of two guitars sometimes. So definitely I've gone, had to go back and go, well, that's how it's worked out on the record. And I'll just try and amalgamate some kind of mix of that when we play live. And I guess either work out what is the most important element in the section, or it's like it might have a lead riff or a rhythm guitar. But yeah, most of the time it ends up being some like bastardization version of that, where it's like, yeah, I'm trying to do both at once, mostly impossibly.
I don't think, though, that many people would be like disappointed by not having two guitars in that area.
Yeah, I think it's so admirable when I see a band that just has one guitarist, and that's predominantly what I've played in. So when I joined Clowns, I was stoked they had two guitarists. I'm like, it just opens you up to do a lot more. But I just think when you've got one guitarist and they manage to fill that sound up and riff and it doesn't take away from, like, yeah, it's really admirable. Yeah. I mean, I think it's amazing. Round of applause.
Greg Rackwick, everybody.
All right. Well, we might wrap it up there because I know that you've got to go to a family function. But thank you all for coming. If you've got any other questions that you want to ask these guys on the way out, just grab them. Maybe they can answer, you know, them for you. Send you down the right path.
You can ask us anything.
Yeah. Or, you know, messages.
Yeah,
maybe.
Messages on Instagram. We do respond to those as much as we can.
Yeah. But yeah, thanks for coming. This is Coleman's Music, and come and buy crap from here whenever you need it.
Thanks for coming in.
Thanks, guys.